Subscribe to Film Companion for your film fix. Hit the bell icon so you never miss an update.
Hi guys, my name is Rahul Hinduja. I'm an ex-professional esports athlete. I'm also the COO and founding member of Global Esports.
Hi, my name is Dr. Rishindra Sinha and I'm a doctor by profession and a gamer by passion. I'm the CEO and founder of Global Esports.
Hi guys, my name is Mohit Isani and I'm a filmmaker by profession and I've been playing video games since I was 3 years old. I'm the MD and founder of Global Esports.
With Christopher Nolan's Tenet getting a limited release all across the globe.
And the trailer releasing in Fortnite, a video game.
It's the perfect combination of a video game and movies coming together.
You're watching FC Game Station.
So guys, we've told you a ton about the content side of things. Now let's talk a little bit about performance. Esports is a wide variety of worlds. There's so many game titles out there and there's so many genre of games from FPS to MOBAs. There are 100 esports games out there. Basically, esports is competitive gaming. FPS games stand for first person shooter games and MOBA games stand for
multiplayer online battle arena, guys. For those who don't know, first person shooters have been in the trend, or the competitive nature of these games is very highly in demand because it's like five players battling the rest of the five players and it's like team and team action that really gets you. And honestly, FPS or first person shooters are very easy to understand because it's like literally you're just clicking heads, right? At the end of the day, you're just shooting enemies, right?
No, I wish
all the time, but
I mean most of the times.
No, I think more importantly, the essence of esports is very similar to what sports is. It brings out that competitive nature where you have either a single player or a team of players going up against each other in a competitive format, whether that's in a stadium or whether that's online. Of course, stadium events aren't as much anymore, but back in its glory, just earlier this year, we had game tournaments filling out stadiums with 50 to 60,000 people sitting in a stadium watching the tournaments like the League of Legends finals last year or the international, no different than any other big sporting event.
Not.
And again, the League of Legends tournament, 99 million people watching online.
Right. And I think, most of us have started with the esports being a forefront of what, what we've been doing in this industry. We started as professional players where we got involved, whether it's in a clan or some big tournament that we wanted to play. And just having that, competitive spirit around you. You're prepping for the tournament. You're going through practice scrims or, practice matches. You're trying to improve your skills, not just individually, but with your team. And just that entire, the series of, events that do take place when you're training for a tournament is exactly the kind of schedule you would follow while playing any traditional sport.
Yeah, I think Indians are inherently competitive. And Rahul, you can give a great example of that because you recently competed on stage at the World Cup.
Right. I mean, okay.
About a year ago now, but
to draw a bit of comparisons, when I started playing video games, when I started playing esports, back in my day,
back in the day, sure.
to not be very boomery, back in my day, we didn't have schedules, we didn't have boot camps, we didn't have training facilities where an athlete would train, and an esports athlete would train just like any other regular athlete.
Right.
Like you have, again, to bring back Sachin's example, at spending hours and hours and hours at the nets practicing one single drive and one single stroke. This has become more and more true of esports athletes in today's day.
And I think for every Sachin, you need your Ramakant Achrekar, right? I think the coaches are a really important aspect and people take it for granted. It's not just kids sitting in front of a screen, banging at their joystick or their keyboard or now their mobile phones, which is the latest form.
Right.
But it's not just spending time and more time on the screen trying to get better at the game. It's you need a formalized structure. You need, a schedule. You need a coach telling you what to do, what not to do. It has to be more than just playing. Otherwise, I love giving this example a lot, is just because you're spending more time doing it doesn't necessarily make you better. If that was the case, every taxi driver would be in a Narayan Karthikeyan.
Absolutely.
Yeah, and honestly, it's not just the individual skill as a player that matters. It's you need to have the right mindset, whether you are coachable enough to take that, step towards the next direction, right? Mm-hmm. And it takes really, a time to find out whether the player has those skills because you need to spend that much time. And most of the people, you know, they just talk about the high ranked players. No one is talking about creating new talent. So I think that's become a really big opportunity in esports, where you have the chance now with mobile phones, just taking your phone and trying to compete on a bigger level. All you need is your device and boom, you just get into a match and start practicing.
So I think the entry barrier has just suddenly evaporated, where earlier you would need a high-end gaming computer which would cost you lakhs of rupees, or even a console which is still expensive. Now all you need is the device you have with you, right? You can pick up any mobile phone. It doesn't matter the cost, it doesn't matter the price point. With, you know, even telecom companies now making the cost of internet so cheap, it really makes it accessible and it's just more inclusive now.
Right.
Absolutely. See, what Jio did for the space in India is what the 2000s did for anywhere else in the world, right? The world of gaming and esports in India itself has blown up because of PUBG Mobile.
Right.
And a lot of that is attested towards the today's audience, which is, again, coming back to drawing parallels with Mortal, Scout. These guys started their careers being esports athletes first. They weren't content creators. They weren't.
I mean, Scout just competed in the PUBG Mobile World League. So that's a great example. You can have 3 million subscribers on YouTube and still be competing on world stage, representing your country and bringing pride. And they came second. So that's a great example of showing how you can balance your work and your content creation.
You know what amazes me in the entire esports and player side of thing is that people and, you know, potential players get paid a full-time salary to play video games, and that is something that was unheard while we were growing up.
Absolutely.
Right? I mean, when was the last time you heard that a person is doing an X amount of job to get paid Y amount of salary that month? And that's what these pro players are getting paid to play video games, which is insane, and the price point is just increasing more and more. So finally that world is coming to reality where you can actually quit everything to play video games full time.
Who would have thought?
Yeah, and I think it requires that little sense of maturity in the players as well, right? Which is where what you said, you know, having that positive attitude, coachability in the players and having that right player mindset, because we have to remember at the end of the day, these are all kids.
Right.
The average age of an esports athlete is anywhere between 13 to 25.
Right. Right.
I mean, most esports athletes retire at 26, barring you.
Barring us as well. We just played in the tournament. So
also,
just
also,
say,
I mean, yeah.
To go to say that an esports,
I mean, we came out of retirement to play that, but...
I mean, I was never retired, just saying, like...
Okay. Well, okay, guys, it's clearly established I'm the only retired...
Yes,
athlete.
Yes, you are.
I'm glad.
They made that very clear.
Yeah.
But more on that note, there are an equal amount of support staff, coaches, analysts, people at the back end, nutritionists, dietitians that are working on that are working on a team's progress than the players themselves.
And to accommodate all of this, there are like training facilities or boot camp, as you call it, which has become a popular thing that we see in the esports industry.
Gaming houses, right?
Absolutely. So it's like the teams, along with the support staff, with the coaches, stay in this training arena of sorts, spend pretty much 24/7 of their lives playing video games, understanding how to get better, following a strict, maybe not so strict, schedule and a routine, and just getting better at the game. It's just amazing to see that kind of dedication to play video games.
I think providing that structure and strategizing the entire process is really important, because as you rightly said, right, the support staff is as important. We've seen esports organizations now having psychologists, having physiotherapists, all that has become such a vital part. I mean, I think a great example was our boot camp in Korea, where we had about 25 people living there, along with the analysts, the coach, the support staff, and similarly, even in Bombay, with our training facility and boot camp and our teams living there.
I mean, just to put this in perspective, who makes for the best people that are at the back end, the people managing players before, right?
Right.
The people that have played
Absolutely.
And have been at the forefront before, have experienced that firsthand, have had that connect themselves. And then think about it. That's the performance side. That's the whole angle where you've got all your players living under one roof. Put everybody under one roof, turn on a couple of cameras, you've got pretty much what I would consider is big boss for gamers.
I think that makes for some of the most interesting content. A great example would be, say, if Mumbai Indians or the Indian cricket team had an entire production crew of cameras and social media artists following them around everywhere, showcasing how they live their lives, you know, what they eat, what they do, the friendly banter that's there between the teams, as well as their training schedule, as well as how they train to get there and, you know, represent their country at a world stage and compete in these tournaments for millions and millions of dollars.
What
and
a story to tell.
It's not just happening in the US, it's not just happening in Europe or in South Korea. In India, the prize money is going up into the crores and crores of rupees to play video games.
Well, take the PUBG Mobile Global Championship, for example.
Yep.
$2 million, guys. That's the
$2 million. Yep.
That's the prize money announced.
And this is from
for playing PUBG.
Yeah, I mean for playing a video.
PUBG. Yeah. Sitting at home, playing on your phone.
And it's great, you know, from a player's perspective, because what happens is you start off as a player, you know, exactly like all of us did. And then once you're playing these tournaments, once you're, you know, kind of growing in that entire ecosystem, then you have so many opportunities, right? I mean, there are so many of us who we know, like take us, for example, we have the opportunity to become a team manager. You can become a coach. You can become any of the support staff. You can become part of the content creation team. It's just that you start off as a professional player, but now there's so many routes that you can take up, right? You can even become a caster because you have the knowledge of the game, so you can use it to showcase that game in the most entertaining way to
kind of like cricket, right?
Kind of like cricket,
because
right?
Again, we have to understand that the average age of retirement for these gamers is 26, so they need to have secure, solid career opportunities after that, because a lot of them end up not going to college or putting their you know, their studies on a back burner so that they can pursue this. They need to ensure that they have the right structure, the right support system, because you also have to understand that the pressure and the anxiety of being an athlete. I mean, we've all played on stage. Yeah. We know what the experience is like. It's those high pressure moments at the age of 16 or 18 when you have thousands of people, or, you know, now in the current scenario, millions of people watching you with crores of rupees at stake. That can be a lot for a kid.
Absolutely. And it's not just that, you know, there's this big misnomer that if you played video games, if you were in that world, if you were involved in that world, you could not pursue education.
Right.
Well, guys, that's not really true. In today's day and age, you need an education in media. You need an education in marketing. You still need an education in all of those aspects. What the world of esports does now is it involves you. Even if you're from outside the ecosystem, there's still opportunities within the world of esports.
And I think there's a pretty big misnomer that's there around that, you know, when people say that video games are not good for you or it can affect your health, yes, excessively doing anything is bad for you. In fact, in the world of esports, especially with organizations like ours and all the other top tier organizations across the globe, it's a very clear cut pattern where it's in our best interest to ensure that our athletes are following a routine, are being healthy, are not spending too much time on the screen. I mean, I think our players spend as much time on screen as they do off screen,
right,
because they work on strategies, and that's exactly the job of the coach and the support staff to ensure that they're in a safe environment so that their health is not affected.
Also, what happens is, you know, when you're sitting with the coach, there are so many reviews that you do as a team, exactly how you would do in, say, a football or cricket match, where you do the entire, you know,
yeah,
you
like
go
the
back
board
to
analysis,
go back
guys,
to the drawing board.
Yeah. We're pretty much working towards teaching life lesson to these kids. It's more along the lines of, okay, once you're done being an athlete at the age of 25, at the age of 26,
what's next?
Right.
What do you have coming up? You know, to this, I draw personal experience on hand, right? Till a couple of years ago, I had no idea what I was going to do in esports once my professional career was over. But then all of this came by, and me attending as many tournaments as I did, one of the few aspects that we didn't discuss was the amount of tournaments, the amount of production that you can do, the live events that are being hosted. Now, being able to attend so many events, you being able to attend so many events. After attending these many events, you know exactly what the crowd wants to see. You know exactly what the audience, the esports audience, the gaming audience wants to see. So you kind of grow attuned to that, and you want to keep working towards creating something new and something more amazing.
I think, you know, the performance side of things, one thing we didn't talk about was because, you know, these athletes are so young, they start off at a really early age. That's exactly the reason why a structure is needed in this ecosystem of esports and gaming, because you need a clear direction in what are the next steps my son or my, you know, daughter needs to take in terms to make esports or gaming a full-time career. How do you do that? That's exactly the reason we are working on a back end to create that entire ecosystem. So when you want to take a step into this world, we are right there waiting for you with, you know, 100 opportunities.
And I think that's exactly why we have our player contracts in place, where the contracts that are there in esports right now, which some of the top organizations do use, are very similar to those used in the IPL or EPL. So we draw a lot of comparison with football and cricket. The reason being is that all the contracts are structured in a similar way so that we can secure the kids' future as well as ensure that everything is in place.
Absolutely. And it needs to be like that. And in today's day and age, you can also see it's not just the career opportunities. It's the fact that educational institutes have started to adopt esports. Most recently, there have been degrees and courses specifically for esports. And we're not talking just abroad, we're talking even within India. So the ecosystem as a whole is no longer just a niche of a niche.
Yeah.
It's starting to get more and
more. Yeah, I think we can no longer call gaming or esports a niche anymore, especially not what's happened in the last 6 months, where every other form of entertainment has taken a backseat and esports and gaming has just been at the forefront.
And earlier, you know, we had so many challenges where parents were not really willing to let their, you know, children go and spend so much time on these video games. But now, because of the challenging scenario, the parents are okay for their kids to spend that much time playing video games because it is the safest means of interaction, right? You want to, you know, hang out with your friends, you just hop into a game and play some PUBG or you play some Fortnite and that's it. You had that social connect, you've had that social interaction, you've done those things that you would anyway want to do in your daily lives, but just in a video game.
Yeah, I think that's a big misconception, right? Like gamers are loners and they're in the dark basement just playing video games. I think gamers, at least the gamers that we know, are the most social people because they have more friends online than they ever would, you know, in a traditional school or whatever scenario, where it's come to the point with this. I think in the essence of it, gaming and esports brings back the social and social distancing.
Yeah, so you know, it's because of these things and the challenges that are slowly, you know, kind of the parents are being more accepting. They are now being more open to the possibility that gaming could become one of the revenue systems or one of the industries that their kids can pursue and actually make a living out of it.
I mean, it's not just us saying that because very recently, Prime Minister Mr. Modi, he also said that they're working a lot on making gaming a more viable career option in India by adding it and including it in the curriculum as well as providing more job opportunities.
Absolutely. And what that's leading to is a number of new esports games and new titles coming up day by day. More and more esports organizations, more and more teams that are getting involved in the space, more and more tournament organizers. Basically, the ecosystem is finally starting to represent and understand what it could be,
right?
You know, especially in India.
Right. Yeah, I mean, I remember back in the days, there were not too many opportunities. You know,
almost none.
Yeah, before I became a filmmaker, I wanted to do something in gaming. I didn't know what. So I was looking for these gaming degrees, whether it was development side, whether it was the playing. Obviously, esports didn't exist that time. But there were only diploma courses. That's the reason I never ended up doing anything in gaming. But now, if you know, I go back that many years, I would love to do an esports degree. And that would be the career of my choice.
I mean, as simple as, you know, even with our partnership with Harrisburg University, where we are co-curating that esports degree, both a bachelor's and master's program. And it's not just Harrisburg, right? I know Florida State has it. There are a lot of universities. UCI has started it. And that's just in the US, even in India, as you rightly
said. Yeah, IISM was looking for...
IISM is closely working.
Right.
And, you know,
and it's not just that, you know, all of these universities, they're not just teaching you. What they're doing is creating a platform for you to even go the extra distance after that, especially with Harrisburg's partnership with the Philadelphia Fusion, which is an Overwatch
the
League
Pro
team.
League team, yeah.
They are creating what is essentially a platform for you to go further. Think about Jobware for esports.
Yeah,
right.
For the next couple of years, what do we see as projection in the world of esports? Now, with things like the IPL that have come to a complete halt.
Right.
I'm imagining and I'm seeing the possibility of something like an IPL coming into the world of esports. Something like a franchisee league model coming into...
I mean, that's already there, right? When you talk about things like the Overwatch League,
right,
you talk about League of Legends, talk about Call of Duty.
India specific, like...
I mean, that's happening. It's happening for sure.
It's not a when, right?
Absolutely.
That's how we always say.
That's what the future of esports is in India. I mean, it's going to grow just the way it did across the globe. And it's expanding so fast, especially with the advent of PUBG. I think there are other games like Free Fire, Call of Duty Mobile, the latest PC release, Valorant. It's taken the world of video games by storm. And with more and more users coming on board, it's just becoming more and more of a viable career option.
And more third-party organizations have started partnering up with publishers, these game creators, and starting to get more and more entwined with the entire, you know, understanding of what needs to be created and for what audience they are all catering to.
Right. We've got a chance to go to Korea, and when we were walking down the streets, you see these posters, which not as movie posters, they are not movie posters or, you know, posters of celebrities, but they are these esports athletes who are featured in these posters, and they are the superstars who are, you know, literally like the most fan favorite, and they have so much popularity than even movie stars. The same way you take Bollywood or Hollywood, for example, that's the kind of movie posters that you're seeing, right? But but in esports, now it's become so famous in some parts of the world where they are literally celebrities. They are superstars who are earning millions of dollars and have a fan following that most of these celebs of the movie industry won't even, you know, imagine.
I mean, you talk about brand deals as well, right? In terms of celebrities, as you said, you have esports athletes in China that are signing on as brand ambassadors for Nike. You have esports athletes in Russia that are signing on as brand ambassadors for Head & Shoulders, right? This isn't an eventuality, you know, we're not talking about a hypothetical future. These are all things that have already happened.
Right, and now happening, you know, as we speak.
Absolutely.
And it's not just esports as a whole. Till most recently, a chess player, a North American chess player, was signed to American esports organization TSM. After that, LeBron James' son was signed to esports organization by the name of FaZe Clan.
Simmons joined as well. He's an NBA player.
Simmons. Yeah. So we are seeing those parallels that we talked about. Slowly, it's just completely.
So what do you think of the future of esports athletes? Where do you think it's going to be going?
Again, absolutely, one of the most important things that are necessary in the world of in this ecosystem is right now education. Educating the masses, making everybody understand, which is honestly the purpose of this podcast, the purpose of all three of us sitting here and discussing this entire thing, right?
Right.
So if this were to reach a bigger audience, if this were to reach a massive, a bigger crowd, I think expanding that horizon will lead to even bigger boundaries being created. Because right now, there's maybe, 20 million, 30 million people that are watching and involved in the world of esports. The goal is to try and get that to 300, maybe even 3,000. The world's an oyster.
Yeah, I think that's a really great point where, you know, once people know about this industry and that it exists, can they really give their time and effort towards becoming something in it, right? I mean, if people don't know that this ecosystem exists, how they even convince themselves, convincing their parents.
Wait, I have a very important question. Where does one start? How does one become an esports athlete? Where should, whether it's a parent asking about their kid or a kid that knows that he or she is really good at the game, where do they start?
So
I mean, besides sending us an email.
Yeah, I mean, I think the best way to start is first identifying what is it that you need to do, whether you want to play on the competitive side and, you know, focusing on the esports aspects of things.
Or be a
content creator. That's the major, you know, you could say two divisions in this world.
Absolutely.
But of course, once you kind of know which direction you're headed, there are so many smaller career opportunities that you can take up. And honestly, there have been some that are being created on the go. There are so many opportunities and positions in esports that
didn't exist a few years ago,
which have been created in the past 3 years. So I would say the possibilities are unlimited. I would say ask yourself what game you like to play and why is it that you like to play that game.
Yeah, and I think the other thing that we have seen quite often, especially when you draw comparisons with the world of cricket, is that even though there might be just 11 players on the team, the entire ecosystem around cricket is so much more than those 11 players.
Right.
That exact same thing happens in esports.
And as I clearly said, you do not have to be an esports athlete to get into
absolutely
the world of
esports. Right. I have friends of mine that are lawyers. I mean, I myself am a doctor and I'm doing this. And you have so many other things. You can be a lawyer, you can be a physiotherapist, you could be a social media expert and use all of those skills that have nothing to do with the world of video games and still work in esports. So guys, any parting words? What do you want? If people could go away and have one single takeaway from this entire episode, what would you want that to be? Mohit.
I would want them to start somewhere, whether it's just going back and playing these video games, just go and experience it and ask yourself, what is it that you're feeling? Do you feel you want to get on the, you know, athlete side of things, or do you want to go and experience the content world, right? And that's for me.
Well, my advice to anybody that's never ever played a video game before, here's your chance. The first thing you need to do, regardless of the platform, right? If it's on a PC, go grab that computer, go grab that mouse. If it's on a phone, all you need is a phone today's day. Because we could go on and on and on for days, but you are the only person who's going to be able to experience this if you picked it up and played it yourself. So go out there, try it out. And if this is not to somebody that's not familiar with video games, what are you waiting for? Get into the world, get into this space, because the possibilities are endless and it is literally waiting to blow your mind.
I think for me personally, a great takeaway that I would want everyone to have is, as you rightly said, experience it for yourself. Like, bring out your inner child and go play a game. It doesn't matter. You don't have to compete. You don't have to do anything. It could just be playing a single player game. It could be as simple as Ludo. Just go ahead, play a game, have fun, and more importantly, find that balance.
Yeah, I think that's it for esports, man. Awesome.
All right. Thank you so much, guys. Thank you so much for your time.
It's been a pleasure talking to
you
guys.
It was great.